luncheon session. This is really an important weekend for all of us. In January, we came together, women from all over the country and all around the world, to say with one voice, we're here, we're united,
can't support a Women's March National Convention. And three of the sisters who co-organized this know the story because they were part of it. We were at the 20th anniversary of the Million Man March. I was interviewing Tamika, Carmen, and Leonard. And when we finished with the interview, I said, we put the mics away, and I said, you're going to get a series of phone calls for my television show and radio show. I said, and the reason for that is, y'all have been doing the work while other folks have been talking. And I said to the three of them, no matter what platform that I have, I will put you on those platforms or whatever it is that you're organizing. And so what they've been doing, the New York Justice League with the Women's March as well. And I say that because it doesn't matter if you are a man, you have to use your platforms for good. Yeah. So they know that. And so whenever Linda or Tamika call me, I say, no problem, you do it, whether it's Time Zone Morning Show or TV One. And that matters because you do not change a system if you are unwilling to stand with others to do so. And so that's the case. There are always haters. And I say to any of the haters, if you're not putting in the work, all you're doing is talking and tweeting. If you put in the work, then you don't have time to always talk and tweet. Yeah. So some folks may want to stop hating and put the work in. I'm sorry, let me preach that thing. Go ahead. Let's introduce our panel. Okay. First up, Women's March National Co-Chair. Give it up, Carmen Perez. Give it up for Detroit activist Mama Leela Cable. Mama Lee, you know, I'm an alpha. That we got that purple and gold on, that little mega covers. But I see you. Good seeing you. Next up, pray for him. He's a little pat, he's a little sad and in pain because my Astros beat his Yankees. Serious XM, my host, Mike Thompson, make it plain. And she is associate professor in cultural studies at Oakland University, Dr. Kelly Hay.
Roland, you touched on something. You said when Tamika calls, we say yes. And that's why I'm here. Tamika, I'm looking at you. That's my girl right there. And so I just want to start, I want to ground myself in the sisterhood before I even get started talking. Because, you know, you just said, can you be here? And I said, yeah. I didn't even know what I was going to do. I was going to wear something cute and I was going to show up. That's it. And so, but what this is how this works, right? And so I thank you, and I thank Linda, and I thank Carmen, and you all brought me into this moment, so that's it, that's all. So thank a sister, y'all. We can make this national, thank a sister day. Sister. We started off by thanking Sojourner Truth, like that's the sister, right? So speaking of thanking a sister, I'm gonna start with the sister because also you're local. And it's really important that we recognize that we are in the D. We recognize, and particularly that the opening, y'all, like that opened to my heart, right? With Mama Soul. Like, so we recognize where we are and what is happening on this ground. Can you start us off by grounding us in where we are and like what your life is like and what your work is like in this moment? Well, we start with the sisters and the elders first. We were raised right? I was.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm just loving the energy. It's really an honor to speak. Detroit is just a special place. There's things that happen in Detroit that doesn't get lifted up. But Detroit is really a place where we really have deep relationships. And that's so important for us as we think about what this conference is about and where the power of this conference can go. So Detroit, the Motor City, Detroit, Motown. Detroit, where we have a number of spiritual leaders that is not necessarily unique, but it's part of our network of power. Detroit, where we had Coleman Young, our first black mayor. A renaissance in terms of bringing our African American people into leadership with showing their competency. Detroit has led in so many ways, and we have a real handle on what it looks like in terms of dealing with white supremacy. So as we look at this space, we also need to look at who's not seen. And we, as we're doing the work around water, which is a global issue, and Detroit is at the leadership of that because we have 21% of the world's fresh water. And there's a move to privatize water. And you are participating in it every time you buy a bottle of water.
That's right.
So, bottled water is seen as a commodity, so it gives us a mindset that water can be bought and that water is not free. But water is life, and we in Detroit want to make sure you understand that water is life. So in Detroit, I also want to lift up the fact that Detroit was Rosa Parks' home after she left Montgomery, Alabama. And I had the privilege of being with her for 33 years. And in that time, one of the things that I want to lift up about Detroit is that she was very dedicated to this city. But when she was arrested, the lesson that I carry forth all the time, and I think is very appropriate in this audience, when she was approached to be arrested, the policeman said they were going to arrest her because she did not give up her seat. And she looked at them and she said, you may do so, in a soft voice. So she gave them permission to arrest her. That's power. Say, why do you treat me this way? She said, why do you treat us this way? So that tells us that if we don't practice from the standpoint of we, it's not going to happen. As long as we're going forth in terms of me, we will not have that power that we get from a we. So that message from Rosa Parks is important for me to impart here today.
When the first panelist says white supremacy, like it's like, okay, we're not wasting time. And being one of the women of color in this moment, in the Women's March, and making room, because I know that we literally see y'all making room for women of color. And what I heard about yesterday that there was a panel that was pretty much teaching white women how to be good white women. And I heard it was packed and overpacked. So I want to give all of y'all a hand for wanting to come and do the work and learn how. And that there have been women of color for centuries doing justice work, and we have great blueprints of how to do it, right? And so it's time that we share and teach best practices. So can you talk a little bit about that positioning that you are as being a woman of color in this moment and in this spotlight, and what it looks like to make that kind of work?
Of course, first of all, I just want to say hello, everyone. What's going on? Just go back one second. You know, you said we have to think about the we. And I also want to recognize that Grace Lee Boggs was from Detroit, and she was the one. There's a lane for all of us. And in regards to your question about being a woman of color in this space at this time, I've been organizing for 23 years in different communities around criminal justice reform and working inside prisons, working inside detention centers with our young people, and also doing gender responsive programming for girls and women, as well as doing peace work. And I think every time that I went into community, my biggest, I think, goal or outcome was to listen to the community, facilitate a process where I could actually bring others along. And one of the things that we did in the Gathering for Justice is that we entered different communities, but we built the capacity of the local people to actually sustain the work. And there are moments in which we talk about being at the table, or sometimes some of us women of color have to build the table. Right, you have to be a carpenter, you gotta go get the nails, you gotta measure, you know, how, you know, go get all that stuff. But because there are moments in this movement that there is not room for us. There are moments where people don't necessarily see their liberation balance and our liberation. And I will say, organizing within the Women's March versus organizing within police brutality and criminal justice, they're completely different beasts. One, walking 250 miles for 9 days from New York City to DC, bringing attention to those that have been killed, particularly black people who have been killed by the hands of police, there was nobody funding the work that we did. However, when it came to what happened after November, everybody was putting in money to make sure that they were going to be liberated and part of the conversation. And so I see a discrepancy. I see this disconnect. And I also see a disconnect when us women of color are targets of death threats. Because we are talking about being intentional, intersectional, and inclusive. And so my feminism is inclusive. It's intersectional. It also includes men. But if it doesn't include Muslim women, if it doesn't include undocumented people, if it does not include LGBTQIA folks, then I don't want to be part of your feminism. And your feminist movement. Because what we've been working for in the past 20 years plus, because I'm not here as a representative of Congress, I stand on the shoulders of women who have come before me. There are women like Harry Belafonte, who teaches me every single day that those that are working towards the liberation of our people are only subject to friendship and support. Those that are being divisive are playing the enemy's game.
Yeah.
And so when I get trolled from social media because we want to include certain people into the program, and I get told that I'm a fake feminist, you are erasing my existence.
Yeah.
Because national. I was born to a mother who I didn't know the label feminism until I went to college. And so what I would hope that people understand is that we, as we build together what the fourth wave of feminism is, right? Because there's been the first wave, the second wave, the third wave, maybe we're on the fifth wave, I don't know. But we're on one of those waves. We are the wave. We are the wave. But I hope that you understand that it has to be inclusive and that we have to meet people where they're at, suspend our first judgment, gather more information. And when we organized the Women's March, we understood that it was not about attacking one person. It was about attacking the forces of evil, not people doing evil. So we didn't make it about Trump. He's going to exist regardless because people voted for him. So now are we going to go after those people that voted for him? No, what we're going to do is we're actually going to make an agenda, and that's what we're all here for, is to make sure that we build collective power so that we can win back Congress in 2018, so that we can be intentional, we can win our local elections, so that we put representatives into office that are fighting for our issues. And our issues includes all the folks that you saw here on the panel on intersectionalities.
Thank you. So, what Carmen just really laid out is this idea of, if you center women of color, then we bring everybody with us, right? So if you center, and I'm talking to the DNC, y'all listen to me. A woman of color is patience with no real talk. I'm learning patience with a community that is fresh to this fight. And I'm practicing how to be in solidarity with, you know, women who just got here, right? And how can we not attack them? Because y'all should know. Y'all should know. But and let them learn from us, but y'all better run quick, is what we're saying. No, really, we don't have time. You must listen and trust black women, trust brown women, trust trans women, just trust us, because we've been through all.
I wouldn't have any work to do if it wasn't for a woman out there named Piper Carter. Research partner, he's right down there. Stand up, Rebecca. The reek that we're doing is to study a women in hip hop collective, to study cultural practice as art and politics, where women doing community work are doing politics, and we don't get known for doing politics. And I'm really glad that I spoke almost last. I would have been better if I went without my brother here. Because white women need to listen. You know, if we don't listen enough, we speak first, we want to help, and we don't know what we're trying to help. So one of the things that I'd like to share with you, and I learned all the way into my toes, is from Joan Morgan, who wrote a book a long time ago called When the Chicken Heads Come Home to Roost, and she starts out saying,
yes, for Joan!
One of the things that white women don't share with us is they don't see their white men as brothers, and we don't. We're just patriarchy. They're the problem, right? When black women and men see each other in the community because of white supremacy among other intersectional forces, and we don't have to face that unless we choose to. And we have to if we want to be in solidarity. And intersectionality, if you all know that word, it's a sociological word, means we're not just one thing. Our race, our age, our national affiliations, our faith, our gender, our sexuality, all of that makes us who we are, and you can't just pull out one and be like, oh, I'm gender today. That's not who we are. We're complex, fluid creatures. And as those creatures, we have to reach for each other, we have to listen to each other, and that's what we've learned with Piper and the women in the foundation that do hip-hop politics. They don't just do hip-hop, they do hip-hop politics, they do what Mama Soul does. They teach us lessons about gentrification, about white flight coming back and buying up the town, about Dan Gilbert, John Hance. Those are the people we need to fight. And the conditions that they create for themselves. percent of the population of Detroit is black, and yet who owns Detroit? Who controls Detroit? Who controls housing covenants, water, the distribution of resources, public schools, the police, not enough good people? If feminism has to be at the table, intersectional, solidarity-based feminism, and if when that happens, we are a we. And until then, we're in silos. Thank you.
And I thank you, Piper, for what you have done and what you are doing. I don't even have to ask you a question, because you are sitting here as the lone rock. What do you feel? Just tell us, like, straight from your heart, what does standing in this moment feel like?
Well, first of all, thank you all for allowing me to be the only dude to sit up here. I'm honored and humbled to be in this role. I said to Tamika that I didn't know if I was worthy. But let me just say that as dude, I'm a feminist. In terms of what I feel at this moment, my two-parent household consisted of my mother and my grandmother. When I was very young, my grandmother said something to me, and I didn't understand it at the time. She was actually a very beautiful woman. Most people thought she looked just like me, orange. One day she came home, we came home from church, and she said to me, "Mark, every woman you meet does not want you to be their boyfriend or have a relationship with them. Most women want you to support them and stand for them." She said, every relationship you have with a woman was not always meant to be romantic or sexual. And I internalized that, but I didn't really know what she meant. And I'm looking back on some of the things we're hearing in the news today, I have a feeling my grandmother probably had experienced what was always commonplace, if not assault, there was always been harassment.
Always.
But she came from a generation where you couldn't talk about that. And she said that to me randomly out of the blue, and I never forgot it. What I feel at this moment, when I had the honor of being the first to step to the microphone at the Million Man March, I feel that feeling now. In terms of a whole group of people and a whole gender coming together. I want to thank especially all of the white women who are here. I went to the confronting white womanhood discussion on yesterday. And I've never seen white women admit and talk openly about some of their profiling of us as black men, and acknowledge that some of you have clutched your purses when you see me, or walked on the other side of the street. And so that was a very, very powerful thing for me to see. Lastly, I'll just say, is in terms of intersectionality, what we are witnessing, I think we have to be very, very careful. It's like we have this sexual assault scorecard going on with the media. Somebody every day. But it's deeper than that. This didn't start in Hollywood. And this is where the unity and intersectionality comes in. America has always been about sexual assault. It began when the first stepped off the boat here and assaulted the Native women. With my great-great-great-grandmother on the plantation. And then when black women got free from slavery, the white man turned on his own women and began to assault each of you. So forget about Hollywood.
will never end. You women have the power to get it out. Maxine Waters has the power. If you stand next to her, you can get it out. That is the decision that we must make today. And every man in here, and every man under the sound of my voice, ought not be threatened to stand next to a woman. Better yet, get up under you, sisters, and lift you up.
See, we are live here at the Women's Conference, and it's a privilege to be here in the midst of thousands of women coming together to discuss social issues that involve them. We are Wazobia Global Times. We will continue to promote our interest, we continue to promote the interest of women, we continue to promote the interest of the minority. Thank you so much for watching, and this will also be on YouTube, so if you want to watch it again, you can also go to our channel on YouTube. Thank you so much. Bye for now.